Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, I should say, and welcome to this session of the RISE the training, which is the first one of a series of webinars about gender issues, which is, of course, a particularly sensitive theme topic in a project dealing with vulnerable groups. And today's session is head by Deborah Angeli from COSPE. COSPE is an Italian NGO which is extremely active, especially in the international scenario with projects on refugees, migrants, vulnerable groups. So we asked them to have two seminars, one today and the other one tomorrow, about how to deal with gender issues with this kind of people. So Deborah, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. My name is Deborah Angeli and I work for Italian NGO COSPE. It's about 24 years. And I work particularly on processes of empowerment of groups of women in different parts of the world, but also Italy. And just to present myself, I think it's also important to say that I am feminist and I have always considered my work also part of my activism. And I have always been interested to be feminist in a, let's say, an intersectional and also intercultural perspective, because being a woman is not the same everywhere. And for this reason, I learned in all these years that gender perspective is very important to be connected with an intersectional and intercultural perspective. And that vulnerability, because we talk about that, no? About the concept of vulnerability and how to approach vulnerable groups, and particularly vulnerable groups of women, it's very important to keep together all these levels. So gender, intersectional, intercultural, and also participatory approach. So let's see together why and how all these levels are interconnected. Gender perspective, gender approach. I think that all of you heard, know about this famous word, gender, no? Many donors, many associations, many also international institutions have gender policies. And I want just to say something about that. Maybe I repeat something that you know already, but just to share about this, what means gender perspective, gender approach. In my opinion, I want to be very direct on this issue in the sense that often when we talk about social injustice or asymmetry between North and South of the world or about oppressive political systems, we don't keep in consideration also the patriarchal culture and patriarchal systems that are at the base of these questions. And in the patriarchal system, there are laws, rules, written or not written, which have the objective to keep women as a community of oppression, let's say. And also a group which has to remain in a certain place. So when we work with vulnerable groups, we have always to keep in consideration that, no? So to make a gender analysis of a context, let's say, which can be community, society, a neighborhood, no? But to consider that men and women have biological differences, but on these differences are built social, cultural differences in a power and asymmetric relationship. So men and women are in a way socio-economic, socio-cultural economic constructions, and they relate each other on the base of these socio-economic cultural constructions. Of course, at this level, also religious, ethnic, economic, historical determinations also have their impact. So this is just to give a position on the question of gender. And I wanted to say that because often I find that this word gender, it became a little bit neutral, no? For example, when we speak about gender violence or other issues, like, you know, it's just a question to keep in consideration also the needs of women. No, it's not only this. It's also to recognize that all our societies are built also on these power relationships between men and women, and in favor, in disfavor of women. Mm? This is very important when we decide to work with women, also to have a kind of clear reading about that. Then before, I talked about the intersectional perspective to analyze the vulnerability. So let's keep intersectional and intersectional perspective and vulnerability. What is vulnerability? And what or who define that a person, and in this case, a woman, a girl, is a vulnerable person? I think we have to consider two questions, two levels. On one hand, for sure, in some cases, my being woman or girl make me, in some context, in some situation, a vulnerable person. Maybe if I walk in a neighborhood, in a very peripheral neighborhood of a city at night, maybe I become a vulnerable person just on the base on the fact that I am a woman. And so I risk much more than a man. But then I can be a vulnerable person, a vulnerable woman, for other reasons, which can be cultural, economic, social. All of that can create vulnerability. So, but the two questions, the fact that I am a woman and a girl, and I live in a patriarchal and culture and system and context, make me in a way vulnerable. And at the same time, there can be other situations that make me vulnerable. No, I can be a poor woman. I can be, for example, with a different sexual orientation. I can have a religion different from the majority, or I can be an activist. I mean, this intersectional perspective, which is also to see the different level of vulnerability and at the same time discrimination. So vulnerability and discrimination also, we have to keep in consideration. Also this connection is very important. So you see that if we analyze word after word, let's say our imagery in a way change. Then the participatory approach. So what means to participate? So in this moment, I try to a little bit to talk about in a theoretical way, but it's just to have a common base. Then I will talk about some practical processes, no, how to work with groups of women. But the participatory approach is another binomy of words, very important. And I would like to give a reflection on what does it mean to participate. If I organize something and my so-called beneficiaries, beneficiary is another very common word in our work, and my beneficiaries participate, is it enough? In my opinion and for my experience, I have to say that this is not enough. And unfortunately, in many social intervention, 50% of women are women, or 40% are women. So there is the participation of women. No, I don't agree. And why I say this? Because to be beneficiary of any activity or a service, whatever, means, of course, to have and to take an opportunity, but it's not a full participation. If I am a beneficiary of something, which is an activity, a training, a service, in a way, I have to accept a proposal which comes from someone else, which can be useful for me in that moment of my life, but which doesn't involve me as a person protagonist of my destiny. So to participate for me is to decide. And in deciding, to have also a small experience of power. And for me, power is another very important word, which is connected to empowerment, but I will come to that later. So, a real participatory process means to break with the stereotype of beneficiary, to break with an asymmetric relationship between the person who give help or organize a training or a service and the person, in this case, a woman or a girl, who receive that service, activity, or training, and to start a relationship in which I recognize, I as operator, let's say, I recognize you, the so-called beneficiary, but I don't want to be anymore in this relationship, asymmetric relationship. I recognize you as a competent person. Why I say that? Because I think that when we approach someone, in this case, with a double vulnerability, a woman or a girl which is vulnerable, which is in a situation of difficulty and in search of need, immediately there is a kind of mechanism. So I am the competent person because I can help you or I can give you something. And that woman or that girl is so distant from me, I don't see her really. Overall, I don't consider you as a competent person. You are only a person in need. And this is something which creates a distorted relationship. And why I talk about that? Because when I am in front of you and you are a vulnerable person, I have also to recognize that you have a lot of competencies because you are able to live or survive, it depends on the level of vulnerability, in a very difficult situation. Probably me, which I am an operator, I studied, I live in a comfort situation, et cetera, et cetera. If I am forced to live in the same situation of that vulnerable woman or girl, probably I wouldn't survive or live in that situation because my actual competencies and knowledge are not completely adapted to that situation. So this process of recognizement of that vulnerable woman or girl is very, very important. It's the first step to break this asymmetry of relationship. And in this recognizement, it can start a different role. Me as operator, I start to be a facilitator for that woman or girl to find, to support her to find her solution or their solutions. This is the first condition to create the possibility to participate. And I come to this, to the other word, which is very important, and it's a word that come from the movement of women, from the conference of Beijing, the empowerment, no? Which is not only I have to support, I have to help, I have to facilitate, no, I have to create the conditions for empowerment. What means empowerment? It means to have to give power, because at the end, the question of power is always on the table of our interventions. And to facilitate a process in which a woman or a group of women during this experience can become stronger, can become empowered, means to generate a social capital, a social community of women who are more conscious of their rights, who have more instrument to act these rights, and also to and more instruments to live in autonomy. As you see, to do all of this means to break a lot of stereotypes, prejudice, that unfortunately also our world of persons who work at social level in different direction, and particularly when we work with women and girls, this is very important. So we have to break our patriarchal culture, which because we all, we live in patriarchal culture, and we have to deconstruct our patriarchal mentality. Also for me, it doesn't regard only men to deconstruct patriarchal culture, also women, and also women activists. So this is the first thing. The other thing is to break this asymmetry of relationship between us as operator and the vulnerable women and girls that we meet, considering always this concept of vulnerability, and to consider also this, the intersectional and the interdependency of vulnerabilities and the discriminations, because women, it's true that all we as women, we share this condition no, of being in a way oppressed communities, but at the same time, we are not all the same. There are class, social, religious differences. Okay, I don't know if someone has some questions. Otherwise, I continue.
I don't have a question, Deborah, but I would like to, I think it would be more interesting for me because we are related with vulnerability context. I mean, when you were talking about what makes someone vulnerable, those two questions, can we name those questions in more straight way? That what are those distinctive questions, defining questions?
About vulnerability.
Yes.
Yeah. So if I, quindi vulnerability, okay. The word vulnerability is a word not easy to treat, no? And my question was what make a person vulnerable? Mm? And if I talk about person, I can be very general. If I talk about woman or girl, what to make a woman girl vulnerable? First of all, the question that is a woman and is a girl who live in a patriarchal culture and system. I don't want to talk about other countries. I want to talk about Italy, for example. As I said before, if I walk at night in a neighborhood, isolated neighborhood of my city, Pisa, I am, in a way, vulnerable because of the fact that I am a woman, not because I am poor or other, no? Because I risk to be raped, I risk to be to have a sexual aggression. And if you ask most of women in the world, all women have to face this vulnerability. So I don't go alone, or maybe if I have to catch the car, I run with the keys in the hand, no, because I am conscious of my vulnerability. So when we talk about vulnerable women, we have to consider that women are vulnerable in a way because of the culture, the patriarchal cultures. Then there are other issues of vulnerability. So a migrant woman or a refugee woman who has, who arrive in another country, maybe she has no documents, she has already been victims of many violences, doesn't know what will be her status. It's a very high vulnerability, no? If you compare me and her, okay? So when I say this, I think that it's very important to define this vulnerability. I speak about a refugee woman, but I can speak, for example, about a second generation girl who go to school, who have maybe a darker skin than Italian girl, and maybe she's in a way more vulnerable than boys because she ran certain risks, but also maybe she can be victim of racism. And so her vulnerability is double in a way. So when I speak about intersectional perspective and vulnerability, is a little bit this, to analyze this vulnerability and not, consider that the vulnerability is created by a system in which we are inside. I don't know if I answered.
Yeah. So I actually, it's affected by multiple factors.
Multiple factors. Not only one. Yeah.
Thank you.
And also the context and the moment and the place where you live. I mean, I live in a region in Italy which is very safe. There is a lot of wealth, but maybe if I go in Sicily, for example, it's not like that.
Is it the case, Luisa?
Sorry?
I was asking Luisa if it's the case.
I mean, definitely there is a gap between now, north and south. But this might not be the place to discuss it, but definitely the perspective changed a lot.
I love Sicily.
No, I know. Everybody.
I have many Sicilian friends, so it's not, but.
No, feel free, but it's the reality, so let's face it.
So this is to say that the analysis of the context, it's very important when we want to elaborate to a social intervention and to make a gender analysis, no? Quindi, which keep in count all what I said before, no? So, what instruments do we have? In all these years, I co-developed, let's say, I always like to work with other people. I co-developed three instruments which I want to share with you. First of all, the concept of women and groups of women resource. So it's a little bit connected with what I was telling before. When I want to relate with a vulnerable person, immediately I have to break the mechanism. I know she doesn't know, okay? We have to break that. If I break that, I can recognize that in a certain community, in a certain context, there are some women or girls who are more resource than others. Make attention, the concept of resource is not the concept of leader. I am completely against the concept of leader, which is in reality very common in international cooperation, in many of these, in part of our world, no? So to train, to create leader persons. Because leader is, again, an asymmetric concept. I am the leader and you have to follow me. If I am a resource, it's not that you have to follow me. I am a resource, which means I have something which can, in a way, facilitate others. And of course, all women and all girls, let's take a vulnerable group, are a resource. And some of them are more. For example, I make always this example. My grandmother, she was analphabet. She didn't move from her little village all her life. But when she opened the door and she put the chair in front of the door, immediately, I see all my life till the day she lived, immediately other 10, 15 women of her age came with their chair out of her door to talk or to make some reparation, you know. In a way, my grandmother is a particular resource woman, because she has this capacity. Quindi she had not formal competencies, but she had the competence of create connections with other women and also to facilitate the relationships among women, and also to have a dialogue, also to be a reference point. So when we want to contact a group of vulnerable women, probably this group have many things in common, it can be interesting to identify some resource women with whom our project, our intervention can be in contact as first step. Because these resource women can help the participation of other women. And at the same time, there is also the possibility that these resource women become a group of resource, which can become also a collective space where to take decisions, to elaborate proposals, to take consciousness, etc. I don't know if this is okay. If there is no question, I can continue. And when I have these resource women, the number can change, no? I can also have three, for example, resource women. I make a more practical example. I want to, I have the possibility to make an intervention, social intervention with a group of migrant women in my city. And these migrant women live in a very isolated condition. They belong to different nationalities. Maybe they are home worker. So how can I approach to them? So maybe I can, if I know very well the neighborhood, I can ask to someone that I know if they know some of these migrant women, and if they know some of these migrant women who have this particular competence, no? This particular capacity to be in connection with other women, who have also some time to dedicate to these meetings. They have this, this capacity to have relationship. Maybe I will have one name, two names. I start to contact them. I have one meeting, two meetings. I present them the idea to create a group resource of migrant women in this neighborhood to discuss about their problems, about the problems in the neighborhood, and also to make some proposal. Maybe they say yes, and I can ask to these two women, these two first women, to contact other women resources. We can also define together some criterias. For example, if these two women, these two first women are old women, maybe we can define that the other women can be a little bit younger or the opposite. But the idea is to reach the point in which I have a group of resource women. And then I can work on with other two instruments. One instrument is to make a public agenda of women with this group, which means, what does it mean, a public agenda? Generally, in all contexts, and Italy is a very tragic example of this, the role of women is less public than men. No, if you think, unfortunately, in all the parliaments of the world, most of the persons are men, in Italy particularly. Let's remain in Europe. If you see all prime ministers of Europe are all men, this is the high level. No, but if I also go to more, let's say, approachable level, also municipalities or the regions, or sometimes also in many associations. But let's say that men generally cover public roles, and women much less. And also women are less in decision-making levels. So the point of view of women often is hidden. So it's not so clear, so visible, so known. In this time, in this very difficult moment of pandemia, for example, in Italy, there are a lot of associations of women who are trying, and they did it, agendas of women to send to the politicians to say, listen, there is 1, 2, 3, 4. If you don't see 1, 2, 3, 4, women cannot face in a good way this pandemia and this emergency. So we have the resource group, and to work with this resource group of vulnerable women to create their agenda, which means we have different meetings in which women, in which we as operator facilitate a process, but are the women to define, for example, what are their priorities. For migrant women, maybe the priority can be the access to services, for example, to public services, to public welfare, or the question of the school of the children, or to find a better job. I make some examples. So, well, very, very good. Maybe migrant women can have some difficulties to talk from the beginning about violence. And maybe we can discuss about them if this is not this is or is not a problem. So when you define the priorities, you start thinking what are the problems, for example, concerning the access to public services. And when you elaborate the problems, then you elaborate the proposal. And then you have a kind of, let's say, programma politico. It's not programma politico, but it's a kind of concrete proposals which to meet the different stakeholders or decision-making persons. And generally, when I work with the agenda of women, I always put financial resources to create, also to have the possibility to realize, to implement pilot action. For example, if the question of access to services is a big problem, and it is sometimes for migrant women because of the language, because people, Italian people who work in public services don't always understand, etc., etc. I think all problems that we know. And if this group of women who has that in doing agenda empower itself more and more, can propose, for example, okay, let's make a training, let's propose a training for the operators of the public services to change their mentality and to give them some elements to better understand migrant women, for example, a proposal. And maybe we can, with a group of women, to go and discuss about that with the responsibles of public services. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, my interventions has also some money to make some pilot action independent. So the group of women can experiment power, cioè can experiment also to elaborate an intervention, to elaborate a project. And I have to tell you that I worked with women in many countries. In the situation, the most difficult, maybe the most difficult was in Angola, in a countryside lost in the nowhere, where women at the beginning even don't talk, in a patriarchal system, absolutely violent and discriminating. And we did this work. And it was amazing, these women that at the beginning didn't talk even, and at the end they started up a self-help group for the question of violence, because they all recognized that they all were victims of violence by their husbands, sons, fathers, etc. They obliged, they forced the men of the community to rebuild the school, and also to build the, adesso I don't remember, acquedotto, insomma, to have the, no acquedotto, pozzo, to have the water, let's say, at the community level. Well. And not to be, sorry?
Well.
Yeah.
Oh, well in English.
Yeah, sorry. And not to be obliged to go and search for water. And the women of a community near to them came to them to say, no, but we want to make the same, please help us to make the same process so we have the force, the power to change our situation. So this is a very practical empowerment process, but we have to break this mechanism to see them as poor people, as vulnerable people in the sense structural, no vulnerable people. No, they are vulnerable because there is a context who make that woman, that girl vulnerable. The other instrument that we often use is the research action in a gender perspective. What is a research action? Research action is an instrument of social methodology that generally in the social research, there are the researcher and the people or the context that we want to research. In the research action, the persons who are objective of the research become actors of the research. So in the research action, for example, I make just a practical example, 20 years ago when we decided to set up a women's center in a city in the north of Albania, we started with a research action. And what we did? We found a group resource of women. In this case, we decided to use the university because there most of people going to university were young women. So we started from a group of young women. They brought then their mothers and other older women, and a group of 20 women. They were not researchers, they were not professionals in this, but we supported them to realize this research action. So we elaborated, we decided to, we wanted before opening this women's center to make this research to understand what were the needs of women. And so to understand what this women's center had to had to give to the women. So it was elaborated a questionnaire together with a group of women. It was a big discussion, of course. We decided to involve different parts of the city. And then every woman of the group, when the questionnaire was ready, involved other 20 women that were considered women resource in that particular neighborhood, and also consider different ages, et cetera, et cetera. And at the end, when we realized this research and the results of this research gave us the elements to open this women's center. This women's center is still alive in Albania, it's 20 years. And at the moment, they have a restaurant, they have a B&B, they have a kindergarten, they have an anti-violence service, they make trainings, they make also political, let's say, activities for the women's rights, and they are working in other also cities. So also the research action is an instrument of empowerment. The research action permits to know the condition of women in a certain context. For example, I have to think of an intervention with a group of migrant women or a group of refugees women. And what I do? I decide to make a research action. This research action, I need some facilitator, some people who know these processes to know how to facilitate. I involve a resource group from this larger group, no? Quindi if I have 100 refugees women, I decide to involve 10 refugee women, and I work with them through a research action, to know well the condition of these women. At the same time, I create a group of women who is more conscious, and I can also enlarge, in a way, my intervention, and the research action can give me some proposal. For example, when we make this research action in Albania, the question of the children, cioè the fact that the communist regime was destroyed, and with the regime was destroyed everything of the state, also most of the services, most of the childhood services. So for the women, the question of children, of an education of children also in the early age was a very big problem. Also to be able to work, to be able to do other things. For example, at the beginning, we hadn't considered that. So the research action gave us this in strong input, and we, and the Women's Center was started up with a kindergarten. So it was a mandatory, let's say, thing. Okay, I don't know if you have some questions about that.
May I?
Yeah, of course.
I was considering your first input when you said resource women, instead of calling them leaders, neighborhood leaders or community leaders, you would rather express yourself by saying resource women. And mine is not really a question, but just to share our example with our ties here in Palermo. And maybe you have a small suggestion. So our first strategy was reaching participants through stakeholder centers and these resource women. Now we have specifically one person, one woman, that is an icon actually at local level here in Palermo, as she represents victims of violence and of trafficking. So the key point was the word power, right? When we want to empower, we have to allow you to have a piece of power in order to be yourself, right?
Yeah.
But one difficulty we faced was that this resource woman, she is now the holder of all the power, because the participants are somehow submissive to her because she is the icon.
Yeah.
We as service providers are submissive to her because she is the one who allows us the contact with real life co-expert, as I learned to say, and not beneficiary. So this position of power that she is representing puts the provider or who wants to help, let's say, and the ladies or girls that would like to join the activity.
This is a very, thank you for that, because I forgot to say something very important when I spoke about empowerment approach. All of these must be always, so when we talk about also women resource, in a democratic and inclusive approach. So what I want to say, that this icon that you mentioned, maybe it's a leader, but as I said, leader is one, generally, but two, but it's a minority. And the others must follow. This is not my approach, because for me also the democratic and inclusive approach is determinant, which means, quindi, the collective dimension, group, cannot be a person. We must have a group. Group, small, big group, doesn't matter, depends of the situation, of the context. And then we have to facilitate the dynamic of the group in a democratic and in a democratic and inclusive way. So if in this case the question that we want to treat is the violence, the male violence against women, we must create a group that work on that. And in this sense, we have to understand in Palermo, I don't know if you talk, for example, about the neighborhood where the violence against the women is particularly spread, I think I would study a little bit who can be the women resource to face this particular question. Maybe young women, because they are more able to break with the traditional rules. Maybe the university, maybe, I don't know, no? We have to study. But then we must always to refer to a group, not to only one person. Of course, when in a group there is a person particularly icon, particularly leader, is not easy. The dynamic of the group is not easy. And it depends on how good we are in facilitating. For example, when I generally work at the beginning with the groups, I spend a little some time to let the group discuss about the rules of the group, how the group take the decisions, and what happens if in the group there are some women who don't talk, for example. And always to try, for example, if in this group you are able anyhow to create a group and there is this icon, maybe to facilitate, you can create different roles inside the group. Okay, the icon maybe can be useful for public discourse, no? These persons are a resource, are difficult to manage, but they can be a resource. But then to other women, I give other roles. So I can a little bit balance the asymmetry between the icon and the other women. Let's say that for me, when I meet these problems, I always try to keep in front of me what is my objective. In your case, what is the objective? The objective is to help women victims of violence. It's not the icon. This is my objective. And so I have to create some services, I have to create some initiatives, because these women can receive some help. And if I keep this in mind, okay, this icon person can be useful to this. Maybe yes, because she's very good in talking at public level. Okay, let's discuss about it in a very open way in the group, but you must have the group. And this is her role, but then the others must have other role. Otherwise, this doesn't work. It creates continuously, no? And what happens sometimes when you don't very well facilitate these groups, diciamo, women who are less visible at public level or collective level, they go away and remain the icon and their followers. So in this case, you have, if you have already a group and you see that there is this dynamic, you have to create a bigger group. So you have to insert other women, other resource women, and you have to understand where you can identify them. It's a kind of architectural work, you see? You have, or a puzzle, no? You have, maybe more a puzzle, yeah, you have some pieces, but the entire design you have continuously to build. And it's always a mental, but also intuitive work. We have also to give listening to our feelings, to our intuitions also. Also to our disturbing feelings. Sometimes the disturbing feelings in these processes are the most useful. For example, just to make an example on this, unfortunately my time is always finishing, but just to stop on this, I was working with a group of women in Swaziland, which is a small country near South Africa. It was a long time that I was working with them, but then I went to a meeting and at a certain moment the group started, you know how often happen, but why the project doesn't pay us to build fences in our lands, no, starting asking in a way money, things, no? And it was a very disturbing feelings because we were talking about other issues, more interesting in my opinion. And so I said that it was not possible. The project didn't permit that. And I went home and this disturbing feeling remained to me. And then I said, okay, but I have to use it. So it's clear that here there is a very dependency mentality, no? I am the stranger, I am the white person who come here. And so it's clear that sometimes this asymmetry return. So I have the money, I can give you some money. And then the fence, they want this metallic fence, no? So it's very Western also mentality, no? And then I started reasoning on that and I discovered that people stopped making traditional fences because, you know, the richest ones started with these metallic fences And so they stopped to make their traditional and natural fences. And so the next time I came back to that group and I opened the discussion. So let's talk about that, about the fences. And so it was very interesting. And just to give you the end of the story, because these small episodes are always very long stories. At the end, I involved an old woman who was a very big cooker, who had a restaurant, but had this traditional sense of the food and also how to keep the land. And we make a kind of exchange on the question of fence. So, and it came out that, they want the metallic fences because it was nice for them, because it was a question of a social status. But then the metallic fences need a work that the traditional fences don't need. So it was very interesting, no? But everything started from a very disturbing feeling. So everything is useful in these processes. Also something that we don't like, because the other thing to keep in consideration is that when you give power and you give space and you recognize the other, the other show also something else from her vulnerability, no? And sometimes it's more comfortable to see the others as only vulnerable and not to see them also in different ways. But again, it's always the relationship which in a way can... it's to work on relationship which can change a little bit the process. Okay, I want to finish, and unfortunately we cannot make a small exercise, but I can give you some questions and then if you want, you can make it by yourself. But there are some transversal indications that I want to keep in mind. And it's that when we work with women, we have always to consider that there are practical and strategic need for women. What I want to say. For women, there are some practical needs which has to do with, let's say, their difficult conditions of life. So services for the children, access to health, to have a job, all of these are practical needs. And generally when you work with women, women immediately want to work on these issues, which are very practical. Quindi are needs who regard their conditions of life. But then we have to arrive to the strategic needs. And not immediately, sometimes we can arrive. What are the strategic needs? Are those needs which permit women to break the subalternity to men? So has to do, for example, to work on violence means to work on a strategic need for women. When we work, for example, on the possibility for women to control their body, so on reproductive and sexual rights, I work on strategic needs. So are those needs which permit to break in some way this patriarchal culture where we live, and it's a culture which determine the which influence in a negative way the lives of women everywhere. I don't want to talk about other situations everywhere. So in this sense, to keep in consideration practical and strategic needs, it's always important when we think an intervention and when we talk also about when we work with groups of women. It's something that we have very clear. And of course, it doesn't mean that practical needs are more important or the opposite of strategic needs. But we must have clear the differences, and the best is to work at holistic level. So to put together and to help to facilitate this consciousness of the women on this. And then the triple social role of women. Again, and this is, I will never get tired to say that also in my organization, and it's something which is very, very low considered. Also when we work with very, very, very vulnerable women and groups of women, it's that women have always a role in the family. So women in almost every culture, take care of the children, take care of the most vulnerable persons in the family, of the old persons. So this, it's not me or feminist movements to say, these are statistics, which other organizations say. A very recent statistics say that from the 7th of November, all women work gratis. So we are already started working without being paid, okay? So women have the responsibility of the care of the family. And this is one. So the reproductive role of the women, which have many, no? Children, old people, the most vulnerable persons of the family, okay. Then many women also work. And also if they don't work in the formalized market, the question of to have some money to face the life, always women, let's say the economy of life are always involved. And then also the productive work. I mean, there are women who work and are paid in the formalized. And then there is the communitarian, the social communitarian role. Cioè, if you go in Italy, it's very clear. I don't want to talk about, I talk about Florence, okay? Florence one or Bologna, the cities where the welfare system, I mean, if you go in front of the schools, primary, school, et cetera, you find almost exclusively women, the mothers or the grandmothers. Very few are the fathers or the grandfathers, okay? And you see all the work of connection that women do. Okay, I take your children. Ah, okay, we have to make this letter because the school, we have to change something. Or in the neighborhood, it's experience of all of us. I talk with my neighbor woman to, no, we have to, you know, it's a continuous work, which is unpaid, which is invisible, but which maintain the social cohesion of our communities, our neighborhoods. So also if I am sure about that, this is true for in the poorest countries, so in the poorest place in the world, I verify this. And I can verify also if I have in front of me a group of refugees, women who passed the worst of their life, it is the same. If we don't keep and we don't give value to that, and so we think of intervention only on the productive role or only on wealth, we miss the point, because the life of women is all of that. And we have to give value, to give a reconnaissance, also when it's possible to pay this work. So this is, okay, this is a little bit, diciamo, the two transversal issue to consider. I had prepared the practical exercise, but there is no time. But I can, if you are interested, you can a little bit to think of it. I thought to ask you, for example, decide a vulnerable groups of women with which you want to work, situation, context, place, and make a gender analysis on this. And then, second question, how can I contact them? So define a strategy on the base of what we discussed, so on the base of resource conception, no, that we share. Third, how can we know their needs through a participatory process, a research action, an agenda, focus group, but no, on the base of the two previous points, how we can know. And then how I can define a strategy of action with the groups of women. So when I analyze their needs in a participatory process, how then I co-define a strategy of action with the groups of women. Mm-hmm. So this was just to put in practical what all the things that I discussed with you. I don't know if you have some questions. I am still available.
Are there any questions for Deborah? We have another 5 minutes if you like. It's a shame that we don't have more time, but it's always like that.
I would like to contribute to what Deborah has been sharing, if it's okay.
Yeah,
of course.
Go ahead.
Actually, in our ties, we are focusing on women, refugee, displaced refugee women, especially Syrian and Iraqi.
Yeah.
And so far, I mean, coming from your presentation, actually, from my personal perspective, I added one more needs-based approach, and actually that's related with your last three questions that you just named. So most of the time, international agencies or offices, they are dealing with rights-based approaches and needs-based approaches. So in addition to that, I think within our group we added community-based approaches, because I mean, mm-hmm. when we talk about women, or when we talk about refugees, when we talk about displaced people, they're not single entity.
Of course. You know,
different women, different refugees. So it really differs according to the context. So, and that's one related, I think it's related with the social issues, that community-based approaches. So rights-based approaches, needs-based approaches, community-based approaches. And at the same time, not in terms of the values, they're not the same because of their value orientations. So we came up with value-based approaches. And I think 4+1 is what you said is strategic needs approaches, strategically how we can approach them, possibly. So that's, I just wanted to highlight.
Yeah, for example, just to make an example, if where are you from? Where do you live?
Turkey.
So, for example, I think that with migrant and refugee persons, and in this case, women, I think it's always interesting to, as you said, for the community-based approach, it's always interesting, in my opinion, to work with some resource women refugees or migrant and Turkish women resource. Because in this case, the question of I am migrant, I am a refugee in a foreigner country. And the question of how, and my vulnerability, I have many vulnerability, but one of these important vulnerability is the fact that I have not anymore my country for different reasons, and I am in a new country which react towards me in a different way, generally not positive, let's say, generally. Mm. So in my opinion, for example, if I work with, I want to work with refugee women, Syrian and Iraqi, I would like to create a mixed group. So refugee and Turkish resource women. So to create a mixed group, because in working with the mixed resource group, I already put on the table one of the questions, which is, can we live in the same space even if I come, my origins, my language, my religion is in another way, in another part of the world? Mm? And how the fact that we are all women and we share, in spite of our religions, languages, stories, the same condition, this can help us to find a common solution in the name of a social cohesion that we all need, the refugees and the Turkish women. So in this case, you see, I am always to have very clear in mind what are the contradictions of the reality on which I want to work, and to put all on the table and to build an architecture of the intervention where these contradictions are visible. In this case, for the refugees, the question to live in a country which is not their country, and for the Turkish, to have people who came for different reasons, and maybe I have some doubts about that. I don't know if so. You said many things. Needs, always remember that needs, there are practical and strategic needs for women. Community, so my invitation is to create common spaces. And then what you said, sorry, community needs, rights.
Needs-based, okay. Community and value-based. Value.
Okay, well, concerning rights, I want to say this. In my opinion, it's not only my opinion, but anyhow, rights cannot be learned. I mean, rights cannot be, like the question, rights is to exercise my possibility, okay? Of course, if I know what are my rights, it's better. If I am in a foreign country and I know, for example, what the laws say about certain rights, of course, it's always useful. But if I know that if my husband beat me and this is not legal and he's not his rights to do it, the fact that I know this doesn't change. Okay, so in this sense, rights, fine, but we have always to connect rights with the question of power. So if I don't have the power to exercise that right, doesn't change my condition. The question of value is not so clear for me, but maybe you can say something.
I can comment on that. I mean, very quickly, I can benefit from what cultural values theoretician Gerhard Hofstede has shared in terms of cultural dimensions. Mm-hmm. For example, in one culture, while their people are, in terms of their values, they're competition oriented, in some other cultures they may be cooperation oriented, or mm-hmm. in some cultures, while they are openness oriented, in some other cultures they may be authority oriented. So actually each culture they have their own value orientations. So we just came up with that particular, so essentially Iraqis or Syrians or Italians or Turks, we definitely have some cultural dimensions, and they appear as value statements, value positionings.
Okay, I understand. Just concerning women, I think that we agree, just to make attention that women rights are not culturally determined. I mean, the question of autonomy and the freedom of women is not cannot culturally be determined, which doesn't mean that I go in an Arab country to say the veil is not good, no? But it's always to open, to keep in mind that the question of self-determination, freedom, autonomy of women, which in my opinion is means also self-determination, freedom, and autonomy of men, it's something which must remain our, let's say, goal in a way. Then, of course, it's not that I my conception of self-determination or autonomy of freedom is the same also of my neighbor in Italy. So
Deborah,
I don't have
to... Very sorry for interrupting. When I said culturally, I still keep my position in that sense, because, for example, culturally, for example, the role of women in society that may turn into a social norm. And it happens because of the cultural patterns that exist in the society.
Yeah. But
I do believe that there are cultural issues determining the gender perspective.
Absolutely. What I want to say is that with women, you can talk about that. No, in the sense that it's not that because I work with a group and women don't go out from the house, so I don't touch that point. No, I don't touch. I mean, I want to talk about that and I want to arise consciousness on that. Of course, I don't force them to go out from the house, but to have that, to give a feedback on that and to organize space and space and time to discuss about that. I think it's important. In that case, it becomes a strategic need for those women to be able to sort out from house. And I can tell you that I worked, for example, when I worked in neighborhoods very isolated in Albania, where women couldn't go out from the house without a male of the family. And we started these processes with some first resource women and then a larger group. And then they asked a kind of small center in the neighborhood. The situation changed and these women had the force to ask to go out from the house, from their husbands. I mean, so when I understood the question of value, the question of cultural dimension, let's only make attention that, okay, this is your culture, I don't face this question, because which means, would mean to accept a violation of rights, because, no? Okay. I hope I have been useful. Of course, 1 hour and one hour and a little bit more is not a lot.
We have 3 minutes of coffee and necessary issues.
This is, of course. So I leave you, and it was nice. I hope we will meet somewhere.
Thank you very much, Deborah, for your presentation. As you know, it has been recorded. It will be uploaded to the our e-learning
platform. Okay.
So if you want to share, we will send you the link. If you want to share it,
yeah,
to one who would like to attend.
Yeah, absolutely. And then if some of you have some questions, you can contact me. I mean,
okay. Thank you.
I am available. Ciao.
Bye, everybody. Ciao.
Yeah.